Since the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, the demand for rhinoplasty surgery has gone up by 78%, with the demand for facelifts, eye lifts, and neck lifts also up 69%, 65%, and 58% respectively. But why is that, and why now? The impact of COVID cannot be overstated. The psychological, sociocultural, and economic impacts of the crisis have been readily reported on, with an escape from the news about the virus being almost impossible. With considerable risk in commuting to work, jobs have been moved to working from home, where it's not as essential to travel. And now 62% of Americans are working from home, with similar statistics across Australia and Europe. Throughout the 21st century, the rise in the use of video conferencing has increased significantly, with a 140% increase from 2005 to before the pandemic in 2019. And this figure has skyrocketed since 2019 as people essentially try and live their whole lives from the confined space of their home, with the internet as their main connection to the rest of the world and social community. For those of you in collaborative workplaces, video conferencing platforms such as Zoom have become a new essential element of daily life, with a considerable percentage of people confronting their own facial image on video for hours each day. Now, it's not uncommon to feel self-conscious when looking in the mirror, as it reflects clearly some of your aesthetic insecurities. The rise of Zoom video conferencing has exacerbated this self-conscious mirror feeling, and even more importantly, low-quality video technology can distort this vision of yourself. Today we're going to look at the rise in Zoom dysmorphia and how this has impacted the cosmetic procedures industry, with more and more people shifting towards a virtual workplace and attempting to improve their distorted appearance while video conferencing. With COVID being a once-in-a-century pandemic and advanced computer technology only existing in the last half century, studies on the impacts of pandemics in relation to computerized technology are the first of its kind. Today, we're going to use a study by Shauna Rice and colleagues who extensively interviewed 134 dermatological medical professionals to identify trends in cosmetic surgery since COVID began. To operationalize this, a survey was completed, and this focused on cosmetic consult trends, clients' concerns with video conferencing, and the physical areas of concern for most patients. Quickly interpreting the demographics data of this survey, we can see that the majority of dermatologists, 85%, were female, with the largest percentage of professionals being between 35 to 44 years of age. Now, if we move on to the survey data, we can see that 80% of dermatological professionals noted that patients were concerned about their glabella or forehead regions, 78% were concerned with their periocular areas or the surrounding space around the eyes, 77% were concerned with upper face wrinkles, 64% with dark circles around their eyes, and about half were concerned with neck sagging and facial dark spots. As the graph shows, considerable regions of the front parts of the face were cited as areas of concern for patients, perhaps a trend that correlates to the frontal reflection found through these video conferencing technologies. I mean, nobody's trying to get the back of their neck corrected, so perhaps the front of view of the camera and the front of view of your perception has something to do with it. As an overall metric of just how insecure individuals were with how they looked since COVID began, 83% of providers marked that their patients were either slightly or significantly more unhappy with how they looked since they started using video conferencing technology. This ties into our previous video on how humans look different in the mirror versus the camera, and the resulting dysphoria that this can bring, but it's not entirely the same thing, as a lot more factors such as image quality, with videos being typically lower quality than a photo, for example, and live facial movements can come into play. Despite the fact that the physical restrictions reduce the amount of face-to-face consults between plastic surgeons or dermatologists with patients, there was a relative rise in cosmetic consultations when compared to pre-pandemic times. In fact, 56.5% of dermatological professionals reported an increase in cosmetic consults, with only 10% reporting a decrease. If we attempt to statistically relate this to the concurrent rise in video conferencing technology, then dermatological professionals reported that a concern for video conferencing was mentioned often in 49% of consultations and was mentioned sometimes in a further 37%, In fact, only 14% of consultations had little or nothing to do with video conferencing. Beyond the visual distortion that low-quality video technology has on the face, then the increase in Zoom-like video conferencing is similar to the rise in social media, which has strong correlations to increased body dissatisfaction and even depression. While it's not a traditional form of social media, Zoom necessitates that people show their faces in a virtual manner, much like traditional forms of social media. And actually, Zoom goes beyond the traditions of normal social media, with real-time emotions being put out on display, which has a physical aesthetic implication of showing increased wrinkles, and also showing elements of the face that are not normally exposed by photos on social media. On top of all of this, Zoom creates a direct comparison between the individual in question and the other people in the video conference, allowing for easy cross-judgment between people, which can further reduce self-confidence and increase self-consciousness. Now, back to the topic of visual distortion. A 2018 study by Ward and colleagues showed that short-range portrait selfies of an individual can distort nose shape by up to 30% when compared to selfies taken at a further distance. This correlates strongly to the zoom distortion effect, where most video conferences film from a shorter focal length, resulting in this broader nose shape, but also resulting in an overall more rounded face, wider set eyes, taller forehead, and disappearing ears that are obscured by the cheek. If there was even more cause for concern, the depiction of a 3D face that's been condensed into a 2D image with a graded shadow can create unnecessary facial dark spots. All of these unrealistic facial flaws brought about by the Zoom platform link to the complaints that dermatological professionals heard from their patients, with a large percentage concerned about the unnecessary facial dark spots and concern for volume loss in the face. To continue watching this video in the virtual world of YouTube or wherever you may be, make sure to like the video and subscribe to the Coos channel to stay up to date with facial aesthetics research and discussion and its link back to cognitive psychology. Throughout the COVID pandemic, it is clear that the massive shift towards virtual living, operationalized through the use of video conferencing technology, has resulted in a phenomenon known as Zoom dysmorphia. This is when patients become more and more concerned and self-conscious about their 2D representation on a video conferencing website and want to correct that with surgical or topical procedures. This sudden rise in dysmorphic attitudes parallels a similar phenomenon known as Snapchat dysmorphia, where the use of certain filters have perverted attitudes and standards of beauty, leading to influenceable teens to seek out cosmetic surgery to look more like their filters. This phenomenon was first scientifically reported on in 2018, where filters such as the baby face filter, the Bryden filter, the high contrast one, the jeweled eye filter, the cat eye filter, and so many more have led to unrealistic portrayals of beauty via artificial editing. This concept does, however, lead to an interesting debate. While Snapchat dysmorphia can be seen as a non-essential social hobby that's gone wrong, if Zoom-like video conferencing becomes the norm for many workplaces around America and the rest of the world, then Zoom dysmorphia will have real implications for people just trying to present themselves as best as possible for their job. Another study by Robert Crystal and colleagues is attempting to see if Zoom dysmorphia will persist beyond the COVID pandemic, and if it does, it will become an important part of aesthetics research and a huge market for dermatological professionals and cosmetics clientele. Exploring the demographics of this sample, of the 158 participants that were surveyed, the majority were female, Caucasian, had a bachelor's degree and were married, with the majority furthering as heterosexual and involved in the healthcare sector. Of this survey, 55% of respondents had a concern with their facial appearance, once again with the nose being the most common complaint, and around 39% of the participants have had prior cosmetics done, and between that point in time and the existence of the COVID pandemic, all of this 39% group planned to pursue further treatment. Alarmingly, once again in conjunction with the earlier study, a large percent of patients were planning to pursue facial cosmetics treatment directly because of the impact of video conferencing, with 40.6% planning to pursue treatments based on concerns from their video conferencing appearance. Results from the survey showed that before the pandemic, 26% of individuals had never even used video conferencing. Yet after the initiation of the pandemic, every single individual in the survey had. It was also found that video conferencing caused individuals to become concerned with their nose, forehead wrinkles, double chin, acne, and neck. Overall, this study reveals a new area of aesthetics that is slowly emerging, and it will likely remain in the future, as more and more of the population are interacting virtually, especially by video conferencing. It is expected that due to this trend, there will be an increase in patients seeking treatment. Specific concerns found from video conferencing platforms like Zoom even after the pandemic ends. So, how can we sum up what we've found in this video? It seems as if everyone's lives have changed since the virus and pandemic began. As a result, certain lifestyle norms are also beginning to change, and with that comes the standard of beauty being distorted by video technology like Zoom. If this phenomenon continues into the future, facial aesthetics research will have to shift in order to accommodate these new client concerns. Personally, I think understanding how focal length works, not sitting too close to the camera, investing in a better quality camera are all things you can do to reduce this dysmorphic feeling, and it's something that's often overlooked. Now that you've watched the video, hopefully you're more aware that this is even a thing. I certainly didn't think it was until we found the research on it. If you want to get your facial aesthetics assessed and perhaps find out if it's Zoom dysmorphia or an actual valid concern, then order an aesthetics report over at the Coov's website. You get 7,000 words of technical feedback written by our doctors and dentists, and it utilizes a plethora of scientific research to give you tailor-made advice that helps you maximize the way you look. As always, if you've enjoyed this video, leave a like, subscribe, comment. I'm quite interested to see some of the comments on whether you guys have been experiencing Zoom dysmorphia. And if you're not following us on Instagram already at Coov Studio, then what are you doing? Follow us there.